Tomorrow, I think, as you know, President Biden will welcome President Marcos to the White House for his second bilateral meeting at the White House in as many years. And, of course, host the first ever trilateral leader summit between the United States, Japan, and the Philippines. First, President Biden will meet bilaterally with President Marcos. The two presidents will mark the unprecedented strength of the alliance between the United States and the Philippines and underscore the historic achievements in bilateral relations since they last met at the White House in May of 2023. They will discuss initiatives to enhance economic and energy security, to bolster maritime cooperation, to invest in critical infrastructure, and of course, to deepen people-to-people ties. President Biden will reinforce the ironclad U.S. alliance commitments to the Philippines. The two leaders will also discuss their shared commitment to democratic values, including respect for human rights and for internationally recognized labor rights. Following the bilateral meeting, the president will host the historic Trilateral Leaders Summit. As leading maritime democracies, the United States, the Philippines, and Japan share a joint vision for the future of the Indo-Pacific. And with this leader-level trilateral, we're going to be taking our cooperation to new heights, adding to our fit-for-purpose network of alliances and partnerships across the Indo-Pacific. Our national security advisors met in Tokyo last June to initiate this trilateral cooperation, and officials from across our three governments have met on topics as varied as economic security and maritime cooperation. For example, Secretary Raimondo will host her economic minister counterparts Thursday morning for a discussion on enhancing trilateral trade and investment. Our foreign ministers and vice foreign ministers have also met. The deliverables and the substance of all these engagements and this inaugural leaders summit builds on the momentum set forth. On Thursday, the leaders will announce new initiatives to accelerate and surge high-quality infrastructure investment in the Philippines, to enhance energy security, to deepen maritime cooperation, and to strengthen partnerships on technology and on cybersecurity. Our three countries embark on this new era of trilateral cooperation as trusted, equal partners, guided by shared values and an unwavering commitment to a free, open, peaceful, and prosperous Indo-Pacific. With President Marcos' visit, the trilateral summit, and of course, the visit today of Prime Minister Kishida, this week will clearly illustrate President Biden's continued commitment to strengthening our key alliances and partnerships in the Indo-Pacific, innovating around shared challenges, and exploring new areas of cooperation. So we're very excited about this, about the visit today, but also very much about tomorrow's visit bilaterally and, of course, trilaterally. And with that, we can take some questions. Yes, ma'am.
President Joe Biden had a phone call with President Xi Jinping, Chinese President Xi Jinping, a few days ago, discussing among some of the issues, including the South China Sea. How do you think it will shape the discussion tomorrow during the trilateral meeting, and what kind of support or solidarity are we expecting from the U.S. and Japan in terms of the increasing tension faced by the Philippines over the West Philippine Sea issue?
Again, I want to stress what I said in my opening statements, my comments. The purpose of the bilateral meeting and, of course, the trilateral meeting is to discuss a wide range of areas where we are deepening our partnerships, deepening our cooperation, again, across a wide range of issues, not just in the security framework. That said, of course, we've been watching with concern PRC activities in the South China Sea. And as you think you know, just a few days ago, we conducted some combined maritime patrols included the United States, Australia, Japan, and the Philippines. And I would expect that the two leaders, when they have a chance to talk tomorrow, will clearly talk about the rising tensions in the South China Sea and I think it'll come up in the trilateral meeting as well, but really towards an eye towards what we can all do to better together to improve our maritime cooperation. And again, I'm sure that the leaders will have more to say at the end of it.
Please pass the microphone.
Sir Katina Domingo from ABS-CBN News. Do we have a ballpark figure as to how much these new initiatives are worth with regard to the, at least the United States?
You're probably talking about the additional investment opportunities that we're talking about.
Yes, that will be announced tomorrow.
Yeah, I'm not going to get ahead of the leaders when they'll have a chance to talk about that in more detail. But the president's very excited about the opportunities here for some joint investment and infrastructure opportunities in the Philippines for the first time, really, in the Indo-Pacific on this sort of scale. But I think I'd let the leaders talk about the details of that.
One question from my end. The White House yesterday mentioned that the U.S. wants to institutionalize the trilateral meeting or deal that will be forged yesterday. What do you mean by that? Does this mean that the U.S. actually wants it to become legally binding?
I think what we're talking about is we want to look for opportunities to sustain trilateral cooperation. So this will be the first time we've done it tomorrow, which again is historic. But in terms of the president's view, who has put a premium on alliances and partnerships, you can't do these in a one-off kind of way. You gotta keep the progress going. You gotta keep the conversation going. You gotta look for opportunities to deepen that trilateral cooperation. So when we talk about institutionalizing, what we're talking about is finding ways to make trilateral cooperation between the United States, Japan, and the Philippines sustainable over the long haul. And just as critically, as I said earlier, a vehicle to talk about our cooperation on a range of fronts, not just from a security perspective, but economic, political, diplomatic, people to people. There's an awful lot of opportunity here between our three countries, and the president wants to explore how we can deepen that. But again, just as critically, keep it going long term. Yeah.
Sir, Alexis Rogero of the Philippine Star. The U.S. has repeatedly expressed concern over China's activities in the South China Sea. With the upcoming trilateral summit, which is historic, can we expect something more than just strongly worded statements or joint patrols with regard to the U.S. involvement in the South China Sea?
Well, now, what do you want? What do you want to see?
So what can we expect after the trilateral summit? Will there be more than just strongly worded statements or something more concrete?
Well, with the caveat that I'm not going to get ahead of the leaders, they'll have more to say at the end of the trilateral summit. I'm sure we'll have conclusions that we can provide to y'all in terms of what was discussed and to what degree things were agreed to. But you've already seen combined maritime activity and patrols. We've said we want to look for opportunities to continue that sort of practice going forward. And we definitely want to look for opportunities to, as I said earlier, to make our trilateral cooperation more sustainable in the future across a range of issues. It's easy to look at all this, and I understand the desire to do it with an eye towards China. And I'm not suggesting that the tensions in the South China Sea aren't important, and that we aren't concerned. I know President Biden is concerned about what we're seeing from the PRC, and particularly in the South China Sea, and these claims that they're trying to pursue. But what we're really after in tomorrow's meeting, both bilaterally and trilaterally, is deepening our partnerships for the good of the partnerships, for the good of the American people, the Japanese people, and certainly the Philippine people. It is not just, and you shouldn't take away from it, that these discussions are just all about China or all about how to counter their growing aggressiveness. Yes, that's a piece of it. But I would ask you to look at it from a more strategic perspective. These two countries, the Philippines and Japan, are treaty allies of the United States. And we take our treaty commitments very, very seriously. But our relationship is bigger than that. I mean, it's very easy to get hung up on the defense relationships, important as they are, but we shouldn't get hung up on that. There's a lot more to discuss here, and there's a lot more purpose to these meetings than just about what we're doing to react to PRC aggression.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Another one?
Good morning, Marlies Omalio, GMA7. I would just like to ask, in what ways does the Trilateral Summit contribute to a broader U.S. effort to promote a free and open Indo-Pacific region?
I kind of talked a little bit about that in the opening and certainly in some of these questions, but one of the first things that the president prioritized when he became president was to revitalize our vast network of alliances and partnerships. Five of our seven treaty alliances are in the Indo-Pacific region. And, of course, Philippines is one of those five. And the president really felt like those alliances and those partnerships needed to be rejuvenated, needed more attention, needed more respect. And he has done that. So he has worked at each and every one of those five alliances in the Pacific, individually, bilaterally, and of course that includes with the Philippines, and certainly with President Marcos. But he's done it with our Japanese counterparts. Certainly done it with our South Korean counterparts, and he's also taken extra steps, not only to revitalize alliances and partnerships, but to forge new ones. For instance, prioritizing the Indo-Pacific Quad by working with the United Kingdom and Australia on AUKUS, on trying to deliver a nuclear-powered submarine capability for Australia, by elevating our strategic partnerships with countries like Indonesia and Vietnam. And I'm actually going to land this plane and finish this answer. And by improving opportunities for our allies to cooperate together as well. So one of the things that he prioritized very early on was the bilateral relationship between Japan and South Korea. And those two countries now, because of great leadership in those two countries, are now developing stronger bilateral relations. And, of course, we are also working on trilateral relationships getting better, too. And that's the same approach that you're seeing here to, this week, tomorrow. It's about investing even more in our bilateral relationship with the Philippines, who we value as an equal, strong, vibrant partner, but also looking for ways to see if we can't knit together additional cooperative elements between now three countries, Japan, the United States, and the Philippines. This is all of a piece. If you go back and look at things that President Biden said when he first took office and everything he's done since then, what you're going to see tomorrow is just the next logical step in terms of improving alliances and partnerships. And your question is, well, why does that matter? How does that contribute? Because if you have more multinational cooperation, if you have deeper alliances and partnerships, then you can move the ball forward on so many other issues beyond just the security element. You really can improve opportunities for workers in all of our countries to prosper more. You can improve trade opportunities. You can look at how you can make more resilient supply chains on things like critical minerals. And certainly, we can all address better, in a collaborative way, the challenges of climate change, which is going to affect us all in the Indo-Pacific. Everybody's going to prove vulnerable to that. So the president believes firmly that as powerful as the United States is, that we can't do everything. We shouldn't do everything. That we need friends and partners and allies to contribute on all these issues and to, again, a rising tide lifts all boats, to raise standards of living and economic opportunities for everybody across the region.
I'm just curious, sir, how does the U.S. view the water attacks by China to the boats of the Philippines and the West Philippine Sea? Do you consider this as armed attack?
As I said, we've been watching those tensions with great concern. And we, again, urge the PRC to abide by the 2016 ruling, and to recognize, as we do, that the Second Thomas Shoal falls within the Philippine Economic Exclusion Area. And we will continue to make that point. When the president spoke to President Xi, he very clearly made our concerns known about Chinese activities in the South China Sea.
Thank you. One last from my end. You mentioned about the quadrilateral joint patrols by the Philippines, Japan, U.S., and Australia as well. How important are these joint patrols, considering that these moves would likely trigger a strong reaction from China?
I'd start by saying, well, certainly these patrols come in the context of the tensions over Second Thomas Shoal. They really are also, again, of a piece of President Biden's vision of improving multilateral cooperation in the region. And I can't speak for the PRC reaction one way or another, except to say there's no reason to overreact to this. This is about freedom of navigation. It's about adherence to international law. It's about proving the simple point that we and our allies will fly, sail, and operate wherever international law permits us to do. And it does in the South China Sea, and we did. And I think you can look forward to additional opportunities for us to conduct those kinds of maritime patrols. But they are really about reconfirming a simple principle about international maritime law and international waters.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. This is Ken Sasaki of Japanese Kyodo News. I wish to ask you about the Japanese Self-Defense Force involvement of this trilateral cooperation. Also, you mentioned about the nuclear-powered submarine, which can be strategically important to protect the international order in the sea. Do you request Philippine side to accommodate nuclear-powered submarines or nuclear-powered aircraft carriers to enhance security in the region?
You mean like for port visits?
Yes. And also, how Japanese Self-Defense Force can be involved into the maritime cooperation. For example, you are having bilateral exercise annually. I mean, the Kamanta or Balikatan or Sama-sama.
Balikatan's coming up, too.
Yeah. Are you going to welcome Japanese Self-Defense Force as a permanent member for these exercises?
So in your first question, that would be up to the Philippine government to speak to, not something that we would speak to in terms of what vessels they might permit port visits. We've, I think, as you know, been working very well with the Philippine government on increased access to Philippine military sites for purposes of humanitarian assistance and disaster relief, pre-positioning and training and improving our interoperability, and that has only accelerated under President Marcos's leadership. So we're very grateful for that. But again, what that could portend in terms of Navy ships and port visits, I'd let the Philippine government speak to that. But we're grateful for, just on a bilateral basis, the improved cooperation that we've been seeing between us and our Philippine counterparts. It's been truly remarkable. And as for your second question, that wouldn't also be a United States position or a decision to make. We welcome, as we have across many exercises in the Indo-Pacific, the participation of Japanese self-defense forces. I mean, these are modern forces, very capable and extremely interoperable with our own. We have a terrific relationship with the Japanese self-defense forces, and I would look for that relationship to continue to improve. And obviously, to the degree that Japan is willing, able, and wants to participate in multinational exercises, we would, of course, welcome that.
Additionally, one more question. Are you welcome to accept Japanese self-defense forces to exercise additional exercises?
So to additional exercises?
Yeah, no, aircraft.
Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement.
ETCA. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Say the question again. Would we?
Are you welcome to accept the Japanese forces to this emphasize, which is now numbered 9.
Those extra sites.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. It took me a while to understand where you're going. Again, that's going to be that's a discussion that appropriately has to take place between the Japanese government and the Philippine government. We have been very grateful for the increased access that we have been able to see, particularly under President Marcos's leadership. And we look forward to, again, deepening our cooperation military to military, but that would really, your question's really better put to both of those governments to talk about. That would be something that that would be appropriate for me to talk to. Yeah.
Just want to, of course, you have an election in D.C. How can the United States as a government assure the Philippines that these high in these relations, these ties, would continue whatever the results may be? I don't want to sound political, I don't want to go there, but we are not sure what will happen this November, but how can the United States assure that these ties would continue?
What I can assure you in the Philippine people, and of course President Marcos and his team, is that as long as President Biden is Commander-in-Chief, as long as he's the President of the United States, we will continue to work hard at this relationship and do everything we can to improve it, because it's so important. All by itself, it's so important. And then when you throw it in, when you're able to look at things like trilateral or quadrilateral cooperation, it becomes all the more relevant, particularly about when we look at what's going on in the South China Sea. Because I work in the National Security Council, I am not allowed to talk about, nor will I talk about, the election. All I can tell you, and again, as convincingly as I can, is that for as long as President Biden is President of the United States, the Philippine people can count on him and this team's full support for improving our bilateral relationship and for meeting our commitments, our treaty commitments to the Philippines. Okay? All right?
Thank you.
All right. It's going to be a great day tomorrow. I hope we get to see you all there. All right. It's going to be a busy day. Busy couple of days. Thank you very much.
Thank you.